well.
You're not going to make it. Your devotion to environmental science will be your undoing. You failed to take a single art class this entire college career.
Listen, Mr. Gooden, how am I supposed to save the world when I'm trapped in some arts and crafts room? I want to learn how to build water filtrations and how to save the atmosphere, not how to use a paintbrush or play a bassoon.
You don't understand. The point of fine arts credits is to expand your worldview and your knowledge. You spend so much time looking down on others for their hobbies not mattering that you fail to even try to empathize with them. I'm signing you up for modern art next semester. This is your last chance. Try and succeed. If you fail, that's your last chance and you're expelled.
Fine, I'll take your waste of time class. Just don't expect me to be the next Monet. Monet.
Good morning, class, and welcome to Modern Art. My name is Miss White, and I would love to get to know each of you a little better. I know this is everyone's favorite part of Syllabus Week, but I'd like everyone to go around and say your name and your favorite type of art or artist.
My name is Jesse Pinkman, and I don't have a favorite type of art or artist.
And why is that?
Well, I don't really pay attention to art. I've never been to an art museum, so I don't know a lot about art or artists.
Well, Jesse, what if I told you that there is plenty of art that lies outside of the walls of a museum?
What do you mean?
Art is located all around us, and we don't even know it.
That's cool, I guess, but why does it even matter if I'm not studying anything related to art?
Jesse, what are you studying here at school?
Environmental science.
I think it is only fitting that we begin the semester studying a type of art called eco-art, and hopefully by the end of our lesson, we can convince Mr. Pinkman that art does indeed matter.
Ugh.
Now, to give you all a proper definition, eco-art is a contemporary form of environmental art created by artists who are concerned about the local and global environment.
Is that even a thing?
Of course it is. Tell me, Jesse, what makes you so passionate about environmental science?
Well, I'm really interested in studying the impact of climate change on our physical environment and how we can find ways to combat the effects of it.
Each of these artists that we're about to study are all trying to do exactly what you just said. Although you're probably trying to create change through your research, these artists are attempting to inspire conversation and change through their art. For example, let's look at artist and photographer Diane Burke. Diane Burke travels all around the world taking pictures of volcanoes, glaciers, mountains, and rainforests. She then goes back to her studio and paints these landscapes as they are. Not only is Diane an artist, but she's an activist on climate change. Her most recent work investigates and captures coral reef ecosystems.
No offense, Miss White, but how exactly does painting a landscape make a public statement on climate change?
I'm glad you asked that. Diane Burke works closely with researchers just like yourself to learn as much as she can about the phenomena she observes. Then she translates their knowledge into a visual format. In fact, the artist even talks about her relationship with scientists. I want my work to accurately reflect the science and the urgency of climate change, and they want me to help them communicate their research to the public through my art. Through facts and images, I endeavor to make the invisible visual and visceral.
Her work is so abstract, though. How does she expect regular people to understand her message?
It is abstract because she's painting her experience. Her work is the culmination of data, photographic images, and discussion with researchers. Much of her work is created using repeat photography, which is a series of images taken over time of the same subject. She does this in order to capture how landscapes change over time.
Yeah, that's amazing that all of that is plastic. She's taking stuff that we just throw away and take it for granted and recycles it in a way that means something.
I'm glad. Now let's talk about a sculptor. Aurora Robson is an American-Canadian artist who recycles plastic to create her sculptures. She repurposes plastic waste that she finds in nature and then assembles the pieces to create these whimsical, colorful sculptures. Aurora Robson says, art is a global language, and pollution is a global issue, so merging the two to find potential solutions seems only natural. What do you all think of Aurora's work?
Is this artist an activist as well?
Yes, she is. Aurora is the director of Project Vortex, which is an organization made up of artists, architects, and designers who are all committed to working with plastic debris. She also works closely with Project Kaisei, which is a nonprofit organization aimed at cleaning our oceans and raising awareness regarding the global problem of marine debris.
Wow, I didn't realize that these types of artists even existed. How did eco art originate?
Ecological art began in the late 1960s and early 1970s when artists began to actively engage with the world around them. Now we've talked a lot about the art, but I think it would be helpful if we talked a little about the science. Since I'm no science expert, can someone please define ecology for me?
Ecology is the relationship organisms have with one another and to their physical environment.
Excellent. Now, what is the key word in this definition?
Relationship?
Yes, there are several ways to define ecology, but in every definition you will find the word relationship. Ecology is all about relationships, and so is art. Art becomes more impactful when we can form a relationship with the piece. It allows us to see, feel, and connect with a message. Art also promotes conversation between individuals, just as we've been doing all of class.
So we've seen how artists employ the help of scientists to create their work, but do scientists necessarily need artists?
Fantastic question. I'm going to turn that question over to you, Jesse. What do you think?
Well, based on everything we've talked about, I guess I would say that artists have the ability to help advance the work of scientists because they make their research accessible to the public.
That's correct. Also, it's important to know that you don't have to pay to go to a museum or a gallery to see eco art. A major purpose of this kind of art is that it is accessible to the masses. Eco art is meant to complement the work of scientists and provide a new way of thinking about our relationship with the environment.
To be honest, Ms. White, I didn't think it was possible for someone to be as passionate about both art and science, but after hearing you talk about it, I can see how the two subjects can actually work together.
See, I told you. I hope you've seen how art has the potential to communicate scientific topics to diverse audiences. Art forges relationships, touches people's emotions, and promotes new ways of looking at issues.
My mind has definitely been changed.
That's great, Jesse. Now that we've learned a great deal about what eco art is, I think it's time for you all to create your own version of eco art. I want you all to create a work of art inspired by an issue that you're passionate about. The best works will be on display at our very own student exhibition held at the end of the semester.
Thousands of tears later.
Jesse, I'm so proud of you. You've gone from someone who couldn't care less about art to being one of my top students.
Congratulations, Mr. Pinkman. Not only have you graduated from school, you've passed an art class. Now, let's take one for the yearbooks. Everyone say, eco art! Eco art!
Don't you forget about me.